God, how many people ready for the word? Anybody ready for the word? Hallelujah. Let's look at Acts 4 and 31, and we're going to get going this morning, amen, in the word. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us, if we look at it, I didn't miss anything, am I love? All right. Acts 4, 31, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own. But they had all things in common, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Father, I pray that I decrease and you increase, that I empty myself and you fill me up, and you be with my mouth, and you save some souls, sanctify your people, and get us on track, oh God, to be the people that you called us to be. We pray, oh God, that we be a light to the Gentiles, God, that we would arise, God, and every single nation, God, would see you work in us, God, and be drawn to you, Lord God. As the Old Testament said, that men out of every nation would grab on to our clothing and say, take us to your God. This is what we want, oh God, salvation for the Hebrews and salvation for the world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Come on, give God some glory, amen. Hallelujah. Saints of God, listen, we're going to do a shorter recap, but here it is. Last time we were here, we talked about the importance of prayer, if you remember. And we talked about the elements of a praying church. We said that prayer was one of the most important things that a Christian could ever do. Amen. It's in the top three things that what we call, amen, the different foundations, the graces of the church. You got prayer, you got the word, amen, and you got fellowship, amen. These are the three essentials, amen, the three pillars of the church. And so prayer is important, amen. And some people would say that it's even one of the most important things. And we save by prayer, we said. We show our salvation through prayer, amen. And anyone who's ever done anything great for God, in the current times we're living in the status quo, or in the past, in antiquity, amen, anyone who's ever done anything for God has been, amen, perennial in this grace that we call prayer. Jesus said it himself. He said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Out of all the names he can call his church, amen, he calls it a house of prayer. And so the church must be praying. If a church is going to be successful, prayer has to be, amen, not just something that it does, but one of the most important things that it does, amen. And Spurgeon called prayer the furnace of the church, the heater of the church, the engine of the church. The old folk used to say it like this: much prayer equals much power. No prayer equals no power. And so we talked about the elements of a praying church and how we can get our churches up to, hallelujah, be operating in this duty that we call prayer. We showed you a correlation between prayer and communication and how a church needs to go ahead and talk and have a communication means so that we can pray like we ought. Secondly, we talked about prayer and unity last time, amen, and how there is a correlation between prayer and oneness. When there is a oneness, prayer is effective. We talked about prayer and worship. The deeper you are in worship, usually the deeper you are in prayer. We talked about prayer and the word and how you use the word in prayer so that you can hang your prayer on a promise. Amen. So you can have something to go to the bank teller in heaven with. Hallelujah. A promise from the Most High God. We talked about prayer in God's will, how when we graduate, amen, and get older, hallelujah, and seasoned in the faith, we understand that we can pray some things, but it's God's will that's going to prevail. Amen. And we got to understand that. And if it don't look like something is working out initially on our behalf, we have to trust in God that eventually all things going to work together for our good. Amen. And that's the prayer warrior that can know the will of God. And lastly, we talked about prayer and petitions, because it wouldn't pay for you to come here and thank God, thank God, thank God, thank God, thank God, and never get into asking God for anything. We got people that thank God in prayer, but they don't petition God in prayer. Prayer is a time of petitioning God. You got to ask, because if you ask not, you always gonna have not. Anybody hear me up in here? Hallelujah. They got churches that don't know how to teach people how to pray. And that's what the disciples asked him. They say, Lord, teach us to pray. And that Philly, amen, is one of the foundations of our church. Amen. When you come here, hallelujah, if you are open, you will learn how to pray, my friend. Hallelujah. Come on, give God some glory. We want to pick up in verse 31, and we want to talk about this morning the effects of a praying church, the effects of a praying church. And we'll have several points, amen, hallelujah, this morning as we kind of go through it. And I'm going to try my best to move as quick as I can. Some of this stuff you kind of already know or you heard already, but we want to be true to the scripture, and so we're going to cover it, amen. And so as we look at verse 31, hallelujah, the Bible says here, it says, and when they had prayed, all right, after they prayed, when they had prayed, some things began to happen. So here it is in our text, God is telling us, amen, the effects of a praying church. When they had prayed, these things happened, all right? When they had prayed, what happened? The place was shaken where they were assembled together. All right, the first effect of a praying church is God's presence. Is God's presence. Amen. Is God's presence. And the Lord gave me that as I looked at it. Amen. When I saw the phrase, the place was shaken. The place was shaken. You see, when God show up, things begin to move. You with me so far? Amen. There's no building that can contain him. Amen. Heaven can't contain him. So when God show up, he overflows and overfills every place where he is. They say the place was shaken. This word in the Greek, shaken, means that the place moved. The building itself, it moved. The building shook. The building shuddered. It trembled. It would be like us being in this place, amen, and while we have in church, amen, the building would begin to vibrate, amen. The building would begin to move, amen. And when it would move, it wouldn't be because of 18-wheeler passing on Evangeline Thruway. It would be because of who? The presence of Almighty God. The building moving was God saying, I'm here. Amen. You prayed for me, and I just showed up. Amen. God has entered the building. Amen. Anybody hear me up in here? It was his way of saying, amen, I'm here. I'm with you. The building had shaken. Amen. And this is not the first time that God shakes a place up. As we look at Acts chapter 16, verse 26, the Bible tells us about Paul and Silas being locked up in prison. Head in the stocks, hands in the stocks, put in the inner prison, amen. And the Bible says, and at midnight, come on, somebody say midnight. When it was the darkest, when it was the worst, when there was no hope, when pain is the worst, when you can't sleep, the Bible says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas, they did what? They prayed. And they sang praises. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. See, after prayer, the presence shows up. And the Bible tells us, amen, in 16:26, after they prayed, after they sung praises, and suddenly there was a what? There was a great earthquake. So that the foundations of the prisons were what? They were shaken. And God, just like in our text, amen, was telling Paul and Silas, you might be in the prison house. You might be in the inner prison. It might be midnight. You might be in pain. You might be, amen, thinking that there's no hope, no way of getting out your situation. But I'm going to shake some things up because I'm here with you. Oh, come on, somebody. And when God showed up, immediately all the doors were open. And everyone bands, their handcuffs, their shackles, they were loose. Because what the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. You can't be bound when God show up. Amen. Where his presence is, there's going to be a loosing. There's going to be a bursting, a breaking asunder. Amen. That's just the way his presence is. And so the shaking here in 31 is just a token. A token of God showing that I'm here. You see, because a lot of the times God can be in a place and you can miss him. So God will do some things just to let people know, especially the undiscerning. He'll do something to let you know I'm here. All right? He'll ring a doorbell. You know what I'm saying? You're going to hear something. The shaking is only one manifestation. Just because a place don't shake don't mean God is not here now. Don't you confine God and put God in a box. Because God has a myriad of different ways of manifesting himself. All right? His presence. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 2, amen, he came with a sound. Somebody say a sound. Sound. It wasn't a shaking, but a sound. All right? Acts 2:2, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled the house where they were sitting. That was God's way of saying, I'm here. It wasn't a shaking that time, but it was a sound. You see? As we look at 1 Samuel 7:10, the Philistines had gathered around Israel. And Samuel had just offered up the offering. Amen. And the Bible says to let Israel know that God was there. The Bible says, look at it. And that Samuel was offering up the burnt offering. The Philistines drew near to battle against Israel. But the Lord did what? He thundered with a great thunder on that day upon the Philistines. That was God's presence being manifested. And a shaking, and a sound, and a thundering. In 1 Kings 8:10, another manifestation of God's presence. Amen. And it's the one that I've seen before. God will show up in a cloud. You see? I'm talking about God's presence here. I'm talking about God's presence here. A praying church is going to have some manifestation of God's presence. And in 1 Kings 8:10, and it came to pass when the priest will come out of the holy place, that what? That the cloud filled the house of the Lord. That cloud, amen, is what we call the Shekinah glory of God. All right? We know, Cole, that God is omnipresent. That means that he's everywhere. But when I'm talking about the presence of God, I'm talking about a concentrated presence. I'm talking about a special presence. I know he's everywhere, but in this place, he is definitely here. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking about a concentrated presence. Amen. Where God gathers himself and shows up. And when that happens, there's usually a cloud. And I done walked in some churches and been in some places or been in Philadelphia while worship is going on. And it looks a little hazy. Amen. And you can tell sometimes that's the Shekinah. Amen. The more prayer, the more presence. The more presence, the more Shekinah. The more thundering, the more shaking. Amen. The more sounds we hear. Prayer, one of the effects of a praying church is the presence of Almighty God. The cloud got so thick in Solomon's day, they had to get out of there. God had smoked out the place, amen? They couldn't even minister in there. Could you imagine the cloud getting so thick in here, we got to go have church outside because God's doing some things inside here, amen? That's what they had to do. And that's the effects of prayer. Listen, it's a whole bunch of different ways God's presence is manifested throughout the scripture. Hallelujah. In Exodus, he met with Moses, amen, and his presence was there like a fiery burning bush, amen. Told Moses, take off your shoes, for the place in which you stand is holy ground. For where the Lord is holy. His presence was there. When he took him out of Egypt, amen, as a token of his presence, by night he was a pillar of fire. And by day, he was a pillar of cloud. His presence. But his presence is not only, amen, something that we can see all the time. Sometimes his presence is something that we can feel. Amen. Hallelujah. Sometimes you can be in the presence of the Lord and you don't see a thing. Amen. Because I'm telling you, you got some people who can see. They have eyes that can see in the heavens. You see what I'm saying? And so they can see the cloud. But other times, amen, you're going to have people that might not see anything, you know? And it's going to be a feeling that come upon you. Sometimes you're in the presence of the Lord and your eyes can't stop crying. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes you're in the presence of the Lord and your heart is on fire. You feel a passion. You feel a burning, amen. And that's what happened in Luke. They didn't know that it was the Lord walking with them, all right? But one of the ways they discerned that it was the Lord, the men in the Emmaus Road, I have it for you in Luke, amen, if the sound Buddha put that up in Luke 24, and they said to one another, did not our hearts burn within us? While what? He talked with us by the way. Another manifestation of his presence, and I've felt it before. Anybody ever felt their heart burning in the presence of the Most High God? Your heart is on fire. Amen. Amen, amen. And that's another sign, a token of his presence. Amen. Your heart is on fire for him. Amen. My prayer is that when you would come to church, you would feel that manifestation. that you would feel. Did not our hearts burn while he talked with us on the way? Amen. Hearts on fire. There's other people, amen, who can smell the presence of the Lord. Sometimes during the altar call, I can smell him here. I can smell him. Why you think they call him the Rose of Sharon? Why you think they call him the Lily of the Valley? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. When your husband walk in, you can smell him. You can smell the perfume of your wife. You can smell the cologne of your man. You know, or your man that's coming. Amen? All right? Well, when our heavenly husband show up, hey, he got a fragrance. He got a fragrance. The Bible talks about the fragrance of Christ. Amen. And we can smell him. We can discern him. I'm trying my best to teach you about his presence so that you can discern and you can know it. And you can know that one of the effects of a praying church is that God is going to show you a token, a manifestation of his presence. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me give you the second, hallelujah, effect of a praying church. The Bible tells us in Acts 4:31, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. That's number one. But number two, they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. This is the second effect of a praying church. After they had prayed, when they had prayed, what happened? They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. The second effect of a praying church is the filling of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. That's what the Bible says. That, hallelujah, when you have a praying body, amen, the people are going to be filled up. I know that there's a pastor listening out there. There's a teacher listening out there. And they people, amen, they're dry, amen. The people don't have the unction, the power, and everything that the Holy Ghost brings, amen. With no prayer, there's no power, amen. With no, amen, no intercession, there's no filling, amen. You got to understand, amen, you got to summon the anointing, amen. You got to ask him to come on in, amen. And prayer is the way that we summon the Holy Ghost, amen. And so listen, when you have a praying church, amen, people are filled up with the Holy Ghost. And the more we pray, the more we filled up. Now, we got some new Christians here. Amen. They might say, Pastor, what does it mean to be filled up with the Holy Ghost? Well, amen, biblically speaking, when you filled up with the Holy Ghost, it means that you under the influence of the Holy Ghost. You know what I'm saying? It means that you leave church and you can get a DWI, driving while intoxicated. You with me? But not intoxicated with that drink, intoxicating with that new wine, that Holy Ghost spirit, amen, that living water, the rivers of living water, amen. That's what you're intoxicated. I'm driving under the influence, officer. Where you coming from? The bar? No, I'm coming from Philadelphia Christian Church. And I just can't keep my will straight because the Holy Ghost does. You see? And the Bible corroborates that in Ephesians 5:8. And be not drunk with wine wherein is in excess, but be filled with what? With the Spirit. Meaning that just like wine and alcohol will influence you, just like wine and alcohol get you acting outside your body. Just like wine and alcohol, amen. You ever heard people can't dance till they drink? Amen. Because when you drink, you begin to do things that you wouldn't normally do. Amen. All right. Are people not courageous? That's that liquid courage. Amen. That people get courageous after they drink. Amen. Because normally you're not courageous. Normally you can't keep a beat. Amen. All right. But something have to get in you so you can act other than yourself. All right. Since we saved, we don't drink no more. We don't do alcohol no more. We're not intoxicated no more. But there is another substance that could come upon us to make us act a whole lot different than what we are. Hey, God, we begin to lift our hands in church. We begin to clap in church. We want to dance in church. We want to shout in church. We want to be courageous out there. Amen. And it's not the alcohol. No, I'm not drunk. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. Come on, give God a shout. We under the influence. All right? That's the only way I can come and preach every Sunday. Amen? Normally, I'm a very shy person. And my wife is a shy person, too. But you could be shy normally, but when that Holy Ghost jump on you, amen? It's like the Bible saying, Kings, you become another man, another woman. There's some of you in here saying, I could never do this and never do that. Don't you ever say never, amen? Because you don't know what you would do when the Holy Ghost fill you up. Amen. Some of the people that do the best things, amen, can't naturally do those things by themselves. I could never dance. I could never worship. I could never get up and preach and teach. I could never. No. That's the ones that God wants. You see? Because God will say, all right, you can't do it, then rely upon me. And in your weakness, my strength is made perfect. Now you ready. That's the filling of the Holy Ghost. Why in the world you think he used Moses to the extent that he used? God, I can't go. I won't go. Who am I that Pharaoh should listen to me? I got a list. I stutter, Lord God. I'm tied tongue. And God said, all right, now you're ready. Who had made man's mouth? And let me put my spirit on. Because you ain't going to be worried about you talking. You're going to let me talk through you. All right? The filling of the Holy Ghost. We under the influence. Let me give you three things that the filling of the Holy Ghost means. Number one, you're led by the Holy Ghost when you're filled with the Holy Ghost. It means that he actually grabs you and holds you by your hand and leads you throughout your day. The Bible says in John chapter 16, verse 13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth is come, he will guide you. You see that leading? He will guide you into all truth. He shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. When you're filled with the Holy Ghost, there is a supernatural guidance, amen, a supernatural wisdom, a supernatural knowledge that comes upon you, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Your flesh say go one way, but the Holy Ghost say another way. Your flesh say I want this car, but the Holy Ghost say buy this one. The flesh say we want this house, but the Holy Ghost say hold up, you better get this house. And then you find out there was termites. Then you find out that the engine is blown. The Holy Ghost will lead you when you're filled up with the Holy Ghost. Come on, give God some glory, amen. Somebody say, Lord, fill me with the Holy Ghost. A praying church, you got a whole body that's filled up. It's not just one person, not just the preacher, not just the pastor, amen. A lot of churches come, amen, for one man to be filled, for one man to be led, for one man to show out the mighty works of God. Oh, when the church gonna wake up that God want us all filled. That any one of us will put 1,000 to flight. And any two of us will put 10,000 to flight. That the least of us, amen, could do great exploits for Almighty God. Every single one of us, all the ones that knew their God and loved their God did great exploits. Yeah. A whole church that's led. Amen. We'd look like David and his mighty men. Every single one of us giant slayers. Amen. Every one of us. From the preacher, the teachers, the ministers, the deacons, the nursery workers will come out and preach your sermon. Why? Because we had been with Jesus. And we filled up with his Holy Ghost. To be filled up means to be led by him. Take my hand, lead me. Hey, God, sit on the throne of my life. But to be filled up also means not only to be led in the Spirit, but to walk in the Spirit. And when I say walk in the Spirit, amen, I mean the opposite of walking and doing the deeds of the flesh. A praying church is going to breathe, amen, a church that's filled with the Spirit. And a result of being filled with the Spirit is that we're going to walk in the Spirit and not fulfill the lust of the flesh. You know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, amen, Galatians chapter 5, when it talks about all the deeds of the flesh. Listen, a praying church, amen, the more we pray, we're going to come out of those fleshly activities. And we're going to move into walking in the Spirit. We're going to move into love and joy and peace and long-suffering and goodness and kindness, amen, and faithfulness and meekness and self-control, amen. For these are the things of the kingdom. And if you do those things, hallelujah, hallelujah, you don't need no law. There's no law they can put on you, no commandment they can put on you, because you already fulfilling a commandment by walking in the Holy Ghost. Listen. A praying church is a walking in the Spirit kind of church. There's a pastor here, a preacher here. They have a fleshly church. They have a fleshly church. A church that's short-sighted and can't see spiritual things. A church that's always arguing and bickering. A church with a whole bunch of division in it, a whole bunch of church splits in it, a whole bunch of immorality, adultery, and fornication going on in it. There's churches like that. And if there's a church like that that's listening or watching or hearing on the radio, the answer, amen, the remedy, amen, the prescription for a fleshly church is a praying church, amen? Because prayer will get a church filled with the Spirit and get a church walking in the Spirit. Thirdly, what it means to be filled with the Spirit is to be empowered by the Spirit. And this is where we want to be. Now, a lot of churches skip one and two just to get to number three. No, no, no. I want you to be led. I want you to walk in the Spirit and bear the fruit of the Holy Ghost. In fact, that's the two more important things than number three. But we're not going to skip number three because we need number three as well. I want you to be led. I want you to walk in the Spirit. But I also want you to be empowered by the Holy Ghost. Anybody hear me up in here? To be filled with the Spirit, amen, means that the Spirit of God is powering your engine on the inside. All right? It means that you're doing things not in your own strength. Not by might, not by strength, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. You see what I'm saying? The giftings operate in the church, amen, that's praying and filled with the Spirit. And it's not just tongues, even though tongues will operate in a church that's filled, but other gifts, prophecy, miracles, healings, service, administration, preaching and teaching like you've never seen before, pastoring, evangelism, apostle gift, amen. All of these gifts are going to be coming out, hallelujah, signs and wonders as we are filled up with the Holy Ghost. Now listen to me now. The more we pray, the more the gifts going to come out, amen. And when they had prayed, hallelujah, the Bible says they received a few things. The place was shaken, the presence. The Holy Ghost came and filled them up. They were led, walking in the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit. But it only came by prayer. Now listen to me. Here it is. Look at verse 31 closely because we need to say this. Because some people get filled up when they're 12 or when they're 13. They come to the altar and say, I got filled up, Pastor, when I was 12 and a half. I don't need to be filled up again. The devil is a liar. You need to be refilled. Because as we look at 431, the Bible says, and they were how many? All filled with the Holy Ghost. All right? You got to remember in Acts chapter 2 and verse 4, they were all filled of before. And now all of them getting filled again. It ain't that some of them getting filled, like the ones that never got filled. No, they all getting filled again. They got filled in 2:4. Peter and John was filled when they stood before the Sanhedrin, and when they came to pray, they all got filled again. So the filling is not a one-time thing. The filling is an over and over type of thing. That old doctrine that you just come for that one experience, amen, got a lot of Christians living in the flesh right now. All right? And not living a victorious life. Amen. You got to get a refill, baby. Somebody say, God, give me a refill. In Jesus' name. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Let's keep on moving. Let's keep on moving. The effects of a praying church. So now we see the presence. We see the filling. Number three, boldness. The Bible says, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken. They were filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. Listen to me. Another effect of having a praying church is that the people of God in that church gonna have a boldness like no other. Remember what our Bible says in the Proverbs. Proverbs 28 verse 1. I'm moving around. The Spirit done took hold of me. Amen. The Bible says the wicked fleeth when no man pursueth, but the righteous are as bold as lions. Listen to me. Us righteous folk in Christ, us churchgoers, amen, Christians shouldn't be in the closet while the wicked coming out all over the place. In fact, Christians should be out and the wicked should be in the closet. But because we are not praying, there's no boldness. Amen. When the church begins to pray, boldness falls upon the church. And we walk the streets not afraid about our doctrine, not afraid about our Bible, not afraid about our music. We got Christians acting like the world, the lost people, 5-0 or the cops. We put our Christian music up blasting when it's us by ourselves. A worldly person walk by or a worldly person drive by, we turn our music low like we shame or something. No, 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 you better bump that Jesus music. You with me so far? You better turn that thing all the way up. You know what I'm saying? That's what I'm talking about. We supposed to be bold for the Lord. Bold to share the Bible and the word of God. We hiding our Bible when people come. You know what I'm saying? That's a lack of prayer. When we are praying, when you come out the prayer closet, when a church come out the prayer meeting, One of the effects of being with God is a boldness. All right? Pastor, why is that? I'm just going to forget the notes for a second. Why is that? You see, when you come close to God, whatever's on God going to jump on you. When we behold his glory, we are conformed into the same glory, ever increasing glory. And the longer we stay with God, beholding his glory, we go from glory to glory, changing to the same image. So if I'm on my knees in prayer with the Most High, beholding his glory and close to him, hey God, what's on God gonna jump on me? And if you know anything about your God ain't afraid of nothing. Hey, for God had not given us the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. Why do you think they call God the Lion of Judah? Why do you think they call him that? He ain't afraid of anything. But why should he be afraid? He created everything. The earth is the Lord. And the fullness there. The Lord will walk through and a tiger will come upon me and say, settle down now. I done created those teeth. He ain't afraid of nothing. A sign of somebody who has been with God is a boldness. You have been with your maker. And after you've been with your maker, after you've been close to God, just think about it, my cousin. Think about it, Kev. We in prayer with the Most High, creator of the heavens and the earth. The one who gonna judge men in the end. The one seated upon the throne high and lifted up, omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. Voices, lightnings, thunderings, amen. We come out of prayer, amen, and we go on our job. And we got little puny men there. After we done been with the Ancient of Days, the Eternal Father, the one who never finishes, never diminishes, amen. His power is ever going. So you see what I'm saying is when you have been in prayer with God, you come out and the man tell you you can't witness on your job. Or you come out and they tell you, amen, that you got to keep your opinions about this and about that to yourself. You look at them little puny men after you done been with your big God. You understand what I'm saying? In scriptures, come on. A praying church produces a bold people. And the more we pray as a church, the bolder we gonna get. You with me so far? There's a pastor here listening. Amen. Hallelujah. He's here. And his church is timid. They don't share the gospel witness. The same four people come to church every Sunday because they're not propagating the gospel. They're not going out, they're not sharing. They shy, they timid. The answer to that church that's dying and not growing is prayer. To get a fire in your people. To get your people with God. Because after they've been with God, they're going to come out bold. Amen. They'll say things like Psalm 56:4. It says, in God I will praise his word. In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me. That's a person that's been in eternity. That's a person who has gone from the earthly plane, and I do mean plane. They've gone from the earthly plane into the Holy of Holies and been with their God. And they look at God and all the things of God, and they come out, they look at puny man, they say, I'm not going to fear what flesh can do to me. Don't fear the one who can kill the body, and after that, that's just it. We fear the one who can kill the body, and after he had killed the body, throw the soul and body in hell. You'll say things like David in Psalm 27 when you've been with God. You'll say things like, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When my enemies came upon me, hey! They stumbled and fell. Should a host should encamp around me. Hey, even in this I shall be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. That I may dwell within his house and inquire of his temple and behold the beauty of his name. You see, David said, I'm not afraid of no man. I just want to get in his house. Because if I get in his house, it's going to change the way I look at everything. I'll be able to go in the valley with Goliath while everybody running. I'll be able to get in that Goliath because I done been with God. I done been with God.
Why everybody else who had not been with God, this man looks big. He's there looking at him like a telephone pole. But David had just been with God. He's just not big. He's the biggest. He's just not strong. He's the strongest. And so Goliath, he said, David, look at Goliath. You no match for the Most High God and his people. When you done been with God, listen to me, listen to me. All you got to do is get with God. The effects of a praying church. Listen, you've been afraid of some things. You've been afraid of some things, some situations, some people, amen, some things you're going through, amen. You need to find yourself back at prayer on Thursdays, back at prayer on noonday prayer, amen. And I know as family, wish we was having prayer. Just hold it till next Thursday if you got to, all right? But you got to be in prayer, because when we have a praying church, boldness is going to come out. Amen. And I have in my notes that song, You Are My Strength. I didn't know Brian them was singing that this morning. I have it on my notes. Look, you see it? You are my strength. Strength like no other. Reaches to me. You see? And when God is your strength, you don't have to fear man. You see? Come on, give God some glory. Amen. The more we pray, the bolder we get as a church. Listen, y'all got to start coming back to prayer. Y'all got to come back to prayer. You see, the regulars are here, the intercessors are here, but some of y'all not coming. You see? And I'm not saying like Philly, we do have a packed prayer compared to other churches, but it don't look like this. You see? And y'all need to be at prayer, because the effects of prayer, what prayer produces in the Christian, wonderful thing. All right? The more we pray, amen, hallelujah, the more the presence of God will be here. The more we pray, amen, the more we'll be filled up with the Holy Ghost. The more we pray, we'll be able to speak the word with boldness and witness and bring people in. That comes from prayer. All right? Number four, the more we pray, amen, we'll have more unity, more unity. Amen. All right. And I'm telling you, I'm not trying to contradict myself. No unity blesses prayer. Hallelujah. Unity blesses prayer, but the more you pray, you have more unity. Isn't that something? All right. The Bible says in 31, after they prayed, and then we get to 32. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. I love this. The more we pray, the more unified we become. Pastor, why is that? Prayer is the glue, saints. Prayer is the glue that puts us together. It is. It really is. And when you're not coming to prayer, amen, Pastor, when your church is not praying, there's no glue there. We know this because of the old adage when we look at our families. They say the family that prays together stays together. But it's not only true about a family. It's true about a church. The church that prays together stays together. Listen to me good. You will never be disjointed, feel left out, wanting to leave, or be subject to division if you make sure that you're here for prayer. When you're here at prayer, amen, God's going to take you. When you come to prayer, when you walk in, he take you like a slice of toast. And you do like a slice of toast, you put jam on it. That's what I'm seeing. God put the glue on you. When you walk through that door, and he stick you on Philadelphia. And the vision can't get you to break away. Amen. The church that prays together stays together. I find that the people that do fall off, amen, they stop coming to prayer first. Hey, God. And when they stop coming to prayer, that's when it just all fall away. You know what I'm saying? I see brothers in here who are perennial in prayer. I see them in prayer either every day or sisters every Thursday. And if I had to let them come up and give a testimony to how many people approached them about leaving, how many friends left, how many family members left, hey, hallelujah, listen. And then when I ask them, amen, man, why leave? When the dude who brought you left Philly, you know? Amen?
But when I look at that, you know what I'm talking about, Brother Carl. But when I look at where they at every day, when I look at where they at every Thursday, amen. Prayer is the glue. It unifies us. It unifies us. If you in prayer, amen, hallelujah. And I've been seeing some of y'all. If you in prayer, there's a oneness that comes. There's a oneness that comes. All right? Hallelujah. Listen, so if you're here, I done got away from my notes. Let me get back. If you're here, all right, and you feel like, amen, you kind of falling off, falling away, getting disenchanted with your church home. Now, you ain't always felt like this. The first time you came, this is the best place in the world. Amen. I can't believe this diamond has been here all this time. That's the kind of stuff y'all telling me. But then you began to fall off. You see? And now you want to grumble and murmur and complain. They did that with Moses too. Yeah. All right? You know what I'm saying? Because some of y'all thinking like, oh, people leaving, something wrong with Philly. Ain't nothing wrong with Philly. Ain't nothing wrong with Philly. Oh, no. Number one, it's not a lot of people leaving. That's number one. All right? We don't have a high turnover rate as a church. If you think we do, you don't know church. All right? But I understand that. I'm at a different level of understanding the way church operate. All right? We ain't got no high turnover rate. In fact, when you come on Sunday and you look out, most of the people that's been coming here still come here. You with me so far? You with me so far? And the other pastors are letting me know they don't get too many Philly members. They just don't get them. And the ones they get, them that they got, say, you can have them. Because God didn't want them anyway. He wasn't one of us. But in the life of a church, you don't get this unless you pastor and you be with pastors. In the life of a church, the turnaround of a church, we don't really get too much turnover. Miss Maisha, how long you been here, Miss? 8 years. Sabrina, how long you been here? 5 years. Miss Denise? She thinking, carry my one, carry my her. Probably about seven. Carl?
9 years.
9 years. Doug? 9 and a half. He count every day. You know what I'm saying? Miss Bridget, how long? 8 years? Miss Mary has been, you've been here.
Since y'all opened the door.
Yeah. Miss Mary says, since y'all opened the door. Listen to me good. All right? Since we are praying church, we have a better cohesion. You see? I'm not going to come in and say we don't lose people, because as a church, we're supposed to lose people. Jesus is supposed to come and prune. In fact, I prophesied to you before this little shaking up. I got up and I said, y'all, a shaking is coming. Didn't I tell you hold on tight? Because he about to shake us and shake some things free. Come on, raise your hand if you remember that. Just don't look at me like you don't remember. All right. So every now and then, he shakes, and it's good. For the most part, we have a good cohesion. It's like we held by Gorilla Glue or something. You understand what I'm saying? And what I'm trying to preach is that the Gorilla Glue that holds us is prayer. It's prayer. A praying church. Amen. It holds. Now, anytime you begin to feel disjointed, like you're kind of breaking away, you got to back in prayer. All right? You're going to feel your strongest, your most unified with us when you're in prayer. Let me tell you why that happens. Amen? All right? Prayer brings unity, because at prayer, you will find out what's going on in Philly. You will find out the heart of your pastor and the heart of the leaders, amen, that stand with your pastor. You're going to find out the heart, amen, of the intercessors. You're going to find out the heart of God, his vision for this church. You're going to find out which direction we're going when you come to prayer, because it's going to come out in prayer. You with me so far? You're going to find out what burdens us, who we after, what we after in prayer. All right? That's what happens as prayer. As you listen to prayer, you find out, amen, the pulse of the church. A Oh, the devil don't like that. The devil don't like me telling you that. Prayer is you putting your fingers on the pulse of feeling. And you can hear her heartbeat. It's such an intimate part of our church. If you hear anything really taking place in prayer, amen, you hadn't come close to the core of what Philly is. The intercessors, that's where we at. That's our desires. That's our struggles as a church. I tell the intercessors all the time on Thursday or whatever, I say, y'all find out things before the rest of the church find out. Because while we still in the planning phase, I come out to the intercessors and I say, listen, let's pray about going out for a campaign. Let's pray about going into the neighborhoods and giving groceries. Let's pray about the Hebrews and the Hebrew doctrine. Let's pray about prayer. Listen, you will find out before the rest of the folk what's going on in Philly by prayer, through prayer. And what this does is it puts you in line with leadership. It show you the vision. It show you the direction that we're going and have us all marching in one step. Come on, give God some glory. Give God some glory. Amen. Did that make sense? All right. I got to keep moving. So listen, prayer, the effects of prayer. Amen. Through prayer, hallelujah, we get the presence. Through prayer, we're filled up with the Holy Ghost. Through prayer, we get a boldness. And through prayer, we get a unity. I don't know if there's a pastor listening out there, a leader of a church, and there's no unity in his church. He has a high turnover rate. People in this church only last a year or 2 years. Amen, at the most. A lot of people leaving, a lot of backbiting going on, a lot of gossip going on. If that's happening in your church, pastor, amen, you're going to have to drum up the fire of prayer again. Because as your people come together and pray, it's going to unify them. As they come together and pray and lay down their problems, it's going to give them a heart for one another. Prayer brings unity. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Woo! Here's number five. All right? A result of prayer is generosity. Generosity. Amen. Generosity. All right? The Bible tells us, and when they had prayed, and it's listing us a litany of different things. The Bible says, neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own. Nobody held on to their possessions. Mine, selfishness. And the Bible says, but they had all things in common. The result of a praying church is a giving church. A generous church. Amen. A church that don't mind sharing. All right? Hallelujah. Somebody say generosity. When a church is praying, people will want to give. Now listen to me here. We've been blessed in a lot of other areas that we talked about. We've got some presence here. That's why people keep coming. For wherever the body is, there are the eagles gathered. We have the presence or people wouldn't be coming. We've been blessed, amen, hallelujah, with some filling because we got some gifts going on up in here, prophecy and whatnot. And so, amen. And while we're not the best at it, amen, we have some filling and some power and some leading and some working and some walking. And we're not always in the flesh. Amen. We have some boldness, amen, because we invite people to church. We're not ashamed of Jesus Christ. Amen. While we have some unity, we can grow in unity a bit, amen. Every now and then we get a little fire, division, and gossip. But the result of that is just come back to prayer and you're going to feel good about church again. All right? But this area right here of generosity is one, as your pastor, I feel that we weak in. Out of the five that we have here on the board, the five right here, put me up back to five. Out of the five, this is the one that we're weakest in as a church. I'm here to talk with you about it. I got one person say preach. The other one say, oh God. Don't get me wrong. We blessed as a church. And I'm going to tell you why in a second. But we could be more blessed, and we could be doing bigger things, and we could be doing greater things if every single person learned this lesson of generosity. Oh, come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. All right. What I'm saying is that everybody in Philly, every person is not pulling their load. Every person is not. Let me just keep it real with you. On an average, we got about 1,200 people coming here on Sunday. All right? That's just an average. All right? 1,200 people coming. You see? We've calculated that out of the 1,200, only about 200 are given in the biblical way and keeping this ministry afloat. Only 200. And that's 200 in two services. So out of all these people in here, we got 100 in here. Maisha, how many is first service? How many we normally have during first service? We have about 600 to 700 people during first service. Only 100 people. Only 100 people supporting this church. Look what we're doing. Doing with the 200 that's supporting Philly. We got this building. You got sound equipment. You got nursery. You know, we're going in the neighborhoods campaigning. We're giving away cars. We're going and we're buying groceries. We have a school that we run primarily upon the budget of this church. And guess how many people keeping all that going on? Look, and I'm telling you, don't you dare clap if you're not one of the 200. Let me keep it real, all right? Let me pastor you. We're not doing what we're supposed to do in this area. With 200 people, y'all, listen, we're doing things that we shouldn't be doing. We did some figures, all right? That means that about 16 to 17% of the church is paying for everything. The rest of the 80-plus percent come, y'all, enjoying the benefit of giving absolutely nothing. I give my time. I'm not talking about your time. We don't need your time. I'm not talking about your time. I'm talking about your generosity. All right? All right? I'm going to show you in a second. The Lord, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to tithe my time. There's no such thing as tithing time. That's something you made up. Now, if Philly is not your church home, and you come here and you will visit them, and you come here, amen, and you come get the word, and you go back to your church, amen, and stuff like that. I understand that. I'm not talking about you because your tithe belongs someplace else. But if Philly is your church home, and it is the place where you are fed, you know, you got to pull your load in this place. All right? You can't be a freeloader. You can't be a freeloader. You can't just come and get the word, get the air condition, get all the other benefits, and not pull your load. That don't work like that in the real world. You try to do that to Cox Cable. I'm going to draw all y'all channels, but I'm going to let anybody else pay. Oh, y'all used to do that, hook the cable up to the next door neighbor house. And what do people do when they find you? They go arrest you because it ain't right. Well, Pastor, what is my load? I'm ready to pull my load. What is my load? All right? What is my load? What do I have to do to get our church up to the place where we operate in the number five? You see? The first thing you do is tithe. Your tithe. You give the tithe. You got to give the tithe. Listen to me. Listen to me. And I'm going to be real with you. I'm going to be real with you. Other pastors would come to Philly and just be, they would love it. Because as we look at our giving and everything like that, the average giving of the nation in America, if you get into the $20 per person range, you're good. But that's the American way of doing things. That's not the Bible way. God don't say $20 per person. He say a tithe. You see what I'm saying? So in accordance to every other church, we right where we supposed to be. According to God, we not. We not. We not. And that's why the church in America is weak. Is settling for a tip when it should be telling his people that God commands the tithe. It's not $20 per... $20? $20? Listen, listen, listen. Pastor, what is the tithe? All right? Some of y'all don't know what it is, so I'm going to break it down for you. Say you make $100 a week. All right? The word tithe means 10%. I think, did I put those numbers up there, Brent? Probably not. But imagine, 100. All right? What's a tithe of $100? $10, baby. You make $100 a week, all God wants from you. Come on, man. You make $500 a week, like some of y'all do. You make $500 a week. What's the tithe on $500? You give the Lord $50, man. And you don't give it in a place of your choice. You give it in your church home. You give it where you're being fed. You give it, amen, where you're a member at. You give it to Philly. You know what I'm saying? Everything else you do is offering. You know? Hey, God, I'm trying my best. The Bible says you bring that to the house of God. Now, listen. What they are doing here in the text right here in Acts, we're not even ready. We're going to talk about it, but we're not even ready for that. When they're talking about generosity to the place where they were sharing everything, you're not even ready to share 10% with God. How are you going to share the whole? Listen, listen, let me not get this twisted. Generosity is not the tithe, no. The tithe is not you being generous. You come in and you say, oh, I gave my $10, I gave my tithe, oh, I'm great. That's not generosity. You're just doing what you're supposed to do. Generosity is over the, oh, come on. Man, listen, man, listen. We got to talk about it. Because listen to me, y'all. Listen, just the 200 given. The 200, I love y'all. All right? I love y'all. Hallelujah. The ones that's not given, I love you too, yeah. All right? I love you too. But you're limiting the house of God. You're really limiting the house of God. You're limiting the house of God. You know? You're limiting us. We carrying you like dead weight. Did Pastor just tell, feel it at? Yeah, you're dead weight, dog. Because you're not pulling your load. We marching trying to go somewhere and you refuse to walk. We are carrying you. The 200. Man, 200, man. Look at what y'all done, man. Now just imagine if 1,200. This is what our leadership there. This is what we're doing with 200 giving. Now just imagine if. Generosity, man. It's where we weak at. And I'm going to tell you why we weak at it. Because of the world. Because of the devil. Because of him perverting everything, and I'm going to talk about it here in a second, amen. You've been watching that devil vision way too long. You don't want to give to the church, amen. You don't want to give to, hallelujah, the work of God, because the devil done brainwash you, mess you up. You done seen the worst examples of churches, and so now you don't want to give nothing to no church. The devil is a liar, so you won't give,
but you're going to give everything that the devil wants. You're going to give to Cox Cable. You're going to give to your internet. You're going to give to pornography. You're going to give to HBO. You're going to give to Showtime. You're going to give to Budweiser. You're going to give to Marlboro and all the other cigarettes. But you ain't going to give to the house of God, huh? Yeah. 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 You done got played. You done got played. You're building the devil's kingdom while the Lord's house lay waste. You done got played. And I'm here to tell you this. We're not generous enough at Philly. Listen to me. Listen to me. A non-tither, amen, is not all the way in. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. You're not giving it, your heart not in it. I don't care how you play. You're not in it. And if you're not all the way in it, you're not going to get the results from it. Hey! Listen to me. Now listen to me. You got to be all the way in, man. Hey, I'm going to get to it too, sister. Oh, yeah, you prophesying. Listen to me. Look at Malachi. Look at Malachi. Yeah, I'm going to Malachi. I'm going to Malachi. Y'all should praise the Lord. I'm going to Malachi. I'm going to Malachi. Oh, no, I know he ain't going. I'm going to Malachi. Malachi chapter 3. But I'm going to start at verse 7. Because since now that we know we Israel, the tithe plays a more important role. I just want to throw something. James, you caught it. You see, now that you know you're Israel, I gotta take off my watch. I just gotta take off something because I'm getting. Oh God. Now that you know that you're Israel, you have no idea what the tide play in our history and who we are. We was given the tide. It was us. And look what he said. In Malachi, I never started at verse 7. But I saw something. Look what he said. He said, even from the days of your fathers, you are gone away from my ordinances, my laws, and have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, said the Lord of hosts. But you said, wherein shall we return? God, how do I return? What do I do to return? He's talking to Israel, y'all. You know when they ask God, how can they return to him? One of the first things God tell him how to return, he said in verse 8, will a man rob God? Oh, have mercy. Well, prophet, I'm trying my best, prophet. It was ours. It was given to us. And God said, I want you to return. And will you return to me? We said, how shall we return? God said, will a man rob God? You think you're going to return to me while you're robbing me? That we gonna get right in our relationship while your jacking was mine? Listen to me now. Listen to me. The Bible says, will a man rob God? Because the tithe belongs to God. When you work, 10% of your check is not yours. It belongs to God. You see, you looking at your check and saying, I can't give this much. It belongs to him. It's his. No, pastor, I work for that. Who gave you the job? Who gave you the strength to wake up and go to work? Who gave you to go? Excuse my archaic example here. But our tithe to God is like our lease on our life. Our rent on our vitality and our strength. He give us life. He give us strength. He give us a beautiful camp. sky to live under. He give us an earth that's his to walk on. Food to eat, that's his animals, amen. Stuff to drink, that's his liquid, amen. And all God asks is a little rent in return. And that rent, amen, it could be everything. He could take the 90 and give us the 10. But for living in his body, breathing his air, looking through his eyes, speaking through his mouth, living in his home, living and walking on his earth. Listen, hey, God, listen. Listen now. All God asks us for giving us all of that is $10 on $100. That's all he asks. You'll never get a landlord like God. Now, come on, y'all, come on, y'all getting me excited now. Y'all getting me excited now. Now just imagine the landlord give you all of that. Utilities paid because the sun come up. Water, rain. You understand? You understand what I'm saying? He give you gas and everything too. You know what I'm saying? All your utilities. All right? Now God got that whole package for you. And God come and he wait for his rent. And you don't pay that man his rent. But you enjoy everything. Even the house of God, you got the nerve to come in the house of God. Enjoy the word, get built up, pull out of depression, everything. You enjoy everything that God gives you. Even his spirit, even the house, even salvation, you come get everything. And when it's rent time, when the basket come out, during the music, you stay in your seat and you don't do nothing. When you leave, you don't drop nothing in the box. And God looking at all of that, God saying, man, what's wrong? Was I not good to them this week? And so when you leave out of here without doing nothing, God say, will a man rob God? How would you act if somebody was living in your stuff? I know what you would do. I know what you would do. Deli, come on, man. Let's be real. They living in your stuff. You paying for everything here. And when it come time for rent, them people ain't broke bread with you. They got a word for that, what y'all would do. What word that is? You see, but God is good. You see what I'm saying? God is good. God could evict us. He don't. Now, I'm going to show you some things he do to us. He do turn some things off when we don't pay. Oh, come on, somebody. I'm just saying, y'all. We pray first before we pay God. Cell phone bill, ATT, everything. And we try to give God the leftovers. He said, will a man rob God? Will a man rob God? Look what he said. Yet ye have robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and in offerings. You're not doing it, dog. You are cursed with a curse, the next verse. You curse with a curse. You see? They got some people in here, you say, well, I'm a New Testament Christian, and New Testament Christians don't tithe. First of all, you're a Hebrew. That's number one. And Hebrews tithe. We always tithe. That's what we do. Tithe. All right. Okay. Well, I don't believe I'm a Hebrew. I'm a New Testament Christian. Okay. You want to debate with me? All right? In the New Testament, Jesus talk about the tithe. And Jesus tells us to tithe. You know your Bible? Put me up there, Matthew 23. Put me up there. Come on, Matthew. Look at that. Woe unto you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites. Look what he say. For you pay tithe and mint, anise, cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, faith. These ought ye to have done, and not leave the other undone. It's so good. He told the Pharisees, y'all tithe in everything, which is good. Don't leave that undone. But love, judgment, you know what I'm saying? Mercy, faith. These ought you to have done. These are the greater things. That's the things that you focus on first, being merciful to people, being just with people. That's the first things, the things that come out your heart. These things you have done, you should have done.
And what, Lord? Since I do these things, I don't have to tithe? But look what the last thing say. And not to leave the other undone. No, keep tithing. Oh, wait. Give it to me in the NLT. Come on. They don't believe me, man. Look at the NLT. All right? Look at the NLT say the last sentence. You should tithe. Look at Jesus say, yes. But do not neglect the more important things. Go ahead, tithe. But do the hard things, too. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. That's for our New Testament Christians. And I can show you some other too if you want to go there. All right? Listen, if you have any questions about the tithe, you need to come and see me. Call the church. And I'm telling you that because I don't want you to be a freeloader. And I don't want you to be cursed. Go back to Malachi. You curse with a curse. Go back to Malachi. Oh, Pastor, I'm a new Christian, New Testament Christian. I can't be cursed. Christ done been a curse for me. I understand that. You could change the wording if you want. You're not cursed, but you chastened. You under discipline. You know what I'm saying? Just because Christ came don't mean that the laws of sowing and reaping have been interrupted. There's going to be seed time and harvest time until the earth vanishes away. Meaning that just because Christ came, it don't interrupt the natural laws God put into place. Give and it shall be given unto you. But if you don't give, the measure in which you give, it shall be measured back to you. When you, amen, pass somebody up crying, you yourself gonna cry one day. The generous shall be well watered. Amen. All of these principles of sowing and reaping are real, and the tithe is still in effect. And so listen, while you might not be cursed, you under chastening. You under discipline. You under God's displeasure when you're not giving like you're supposed to be giving. And the Lord put something in my heart. I was praying, and listen, the Lord told me clear as day. He told me clear as day. He said, tell him this. And I pray he write it on your heart with a branding iron. I pray he write on your heart with a pin of iron, with a point of a diamond. Because you need to understand what I'm about to say. I got up in prayer, and this is what he told me to tell you, Philly. Listen. I got it so I could put it up. Look what he told me to tell you. They will, come on, put it up, put it up. They will always be broke until they give me the tithe. That's what the Lord told me to tell you. Look. No exception. What you say, Brother Duck? Brother Duck said, I could attest to that. Listen to me. No exceptions. And the last thing I want to do as a pastor is for you to come for a handout to church. And you not tithing? You see what I do when I give you a handout and you not tithing? I'm putting water in a bucket with a hole in it. I could pay your rent. I could pay your... Listen, you're going to keep coming because you're not... The answer is not more handout. The answer is the tithe. Say it with me. Say this with me. They will always be broke until they give me the tithe. I heard it. You believe I could hear from God? I heard. Listen, where you're at right now, if you refuse to tithe, you will be in that same place 20 years from now. Or worse. He said, you curse with a curse. He said, you curse with a curse. That's what he said in Malachi. He said, you curse with a curse. You see? He said, for you robbed me. And look what he says. This is the chilling thing. He says, even this whole nation. The answer for my nation. The answer for the Hebrews. To put him first again. Can I see it? To put him first again. to put him first again. That us as a people, listen, the heathen, the Gentiles, they're going to do what they want to do. And they're going to preach what they want to preach. And they're not going to be too big on the tie. But for us, we should know better. To us was given the oracles of God. We should know better. The law was given to us. We should know better. And until we get it right, that's why we're in the situation we're in. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Oh, no. I'm not done yet. No, I am not done. Oh, no. I'm not done. Look at the next verse in verse 10. He says, bring ye all. How much of it? Oh, yeah, don't you dare give God part of your tithe. God, I'm going to give you five this week. I'm running short. You know, when we was renting a house in Baton Rouge, our landlord taught us the most important lesson there was to teach. I think I told some of y'all that before. I said, Mr. Kirkpatrick, I can't pay you, man. I got to pay some other things. Mr. Kirkpatrick said, he said, Omar, I'm going to take it this time. He said, but you better pay where you're living first. You better pay your most important bill first. And here we are, paying everybody before God. Paying everybody before God. Even stuff we don't need. Downright paying the devil before God. Listen to me. You better pay your most important one first, man. You better pay your most important one first. Look. I'm telling you. Listen. This ain't really for me, no, y'all. If you knew my heart, you would understand that, number one, this is for you. This is so you won't be broke. As a pastor, I want to see you blessed. But you cannot be blessed until you get this right. All right? Never going to happen. You're going to always be broke. Number two, this is not for me. All right? You think the school is for me? Huh? You think this building is for me? You think the campaign is going out and bringing it? I'm already saved. I already have a house. My children was already going to Westminster. I can do what I'm trying to do for y'all. I can do for myself on my own. The tithe for you giving is not for me. I can do that on my own. I drive, the house I live in, I can do that on my own. The tithe is for you. The tithe is for this church. The tithe is glory in the Lafayette community so people can know it. That's what the tithe is. All right. Look. We ain't done no coke. We gonna dig up in here. I should have wore a bow tie. Listen to me. He said, bring it all back. He said, why? Bring it all into the stores. Why? That there might be meat in my house. Meat in his house meaning that his house can function. That he can have all the offerings, the burnt offerings, everything. There could be meat in his house. And if people were to need, and we're going to get to that next, that people would have a legitimate need that the house could break bread with them. All right, we're going to get in a little bit of that next time. All right? But look at me here. Look at me. So my house can function. Do what it's supposed to do. And for us at Philly, amen, if you can imagine, if we had 1,200 doing what they were supposed to do instead of 200, amen, what would that look like? Huh? The school would be finished. We'd educate all your children for free. All your children for free. I told you, you're tired, your children come for free. You see? We got plans. I already picked out the land and everything. Plans for a cemetery. We already got it. I already got the price. It's right there. All we got to do is sign the paperwork for a place where you could be buried at. If you come on board, you understand what I'm saying? All right? We got plans, amen, for a food pantry. a soup kitchen. You know what I'm saying? Well, we can actually feed some people. What you think, we're going to have all these buildings and not do something with them? I already told you we got the high school. But after our kids graduate from high school, Ms. Karen, what we going to send them to the secular universities then? What I'm telling you is that it would be nothing for us to have a little college, man. That's nothing, man. Listen, I would tell you the numbers, but some of y'all, if I told you the numbers, it'd be too big for you, and you wouldn't tithe because of the numbers. Because you don't like to see nobody but yourself do good, and if the church doing too good, you say that you don't want to tithe no more, so I can't share the numbers with you, but I have the numbers of what we should be doing. But I can't share it with you because of Willie Lynch and Haterade that you're drinking. All right? When you don't know, it's really for you. Don't forget our bank we've been trying to put together. You know what I'm saying? If we do this right, Christians, Hebrews, this could be a model for the churches everywhere. And we would not need a federal government that's trying to get us to do things against God and against his Bible. And there they go, I'm going to take this away from you. You ain't going to get this grant. We don't need your money. The house of the Lord going to operate on the people of God and on the tithe that God said it would operate on. We don't need your money. We don't need your money. The people of God going to do what they have to do. You see, there wouldn't be no need for that stuff, man. The early church ain't never had no food stamp and welfare, Medicare, Medicaid. They didn't have none of that. We do this right, we take care of our own. Now listen to me. Listen to me good now. Let me prophesy. There's going to come a time when America won't be able to do those things. And you're going to come to the church then. Let's build ourselves up now. Let's get ready now. Let's get our ducks in order now. When those things fall, we're going to be able to take care of our own old people, our own sick folk, our own unemployed. We're going to be able to feed our... Oh, God, have mercy. God... Yeah, they don't see, babe. You can't see it? You know what times are coming? You can't see it? We're going to need to come together, man. You see? All right, listen. Why aren't we tithing? Okay, let me just show you some of these things. Why aren't we tithing? Number one, we're not tithing, amen. Let's see. Because some people say the church is blessed enough. Yeah. You know, they say, oh, the church got enough. They don't need to tithe. We don't need to tithe. All right? Command to tithe from God is irrelevant of what the church is doing. He never told you to tithe if the church don't have. All right? That's that. That's a lack mentality. That you don't want to see anything overflow that you got something to do with. And because you don't want to see his house overflow, don't be surprised when you do not overflow. Because God going to look down and use the same rationale because it's going to be given to you. God going to use the same rationale to you. Well, I'm not going to give them this month because they have received enough this month. They blessed enough. You want God to have that mentality with you? You want God to overflow you. All right? All right? Another reason why people don't tithe. I'm not quitting. People don't tithe because money tight. All right? And we're going to talk to a few of our financial guys. Amen. Minister Doug. Amen. G Money. Amen. And Brother Ben Robinson. We're going to put that financial thing together where you can come in and learn how to manage your money. All right? Because if you're not tithing because you got too many bills, usually it's because you got too many bills. And if you got too many bills, amen, it's because you got some unnecessary things that's going on in your life. And like us, you know, we can't see ourselves paying cable. $100, $200, you know. And we got people coming in asking for something from the church when they got every channel. You ain't getting nothing from the church. You're not getting nothing from the church. You're going to pay the devil in the devil vision? You ain't getting nothing from the church. You're watching every channel. You got all your hair done, your nails done, everything like that. And look, not tithing, Kev. Not tithing. Head done, nails done, every channel there is, and not tithing. Parker laughed. All I'm doing is I'm sharing with you how God feels about how we doing. That's all I'm doing. That's all I'm doing. Because we do everybody but God first. So usually, if we don't have enough to tithe, it's because we've put on our too many bills and unnecessary things, and we need to cut some things off. You see what I'm saying? And I think that's the reason why we had first cut off cable, because we things was tight way back in the day. We've been stopped cable since Baton Rouge, I think. You see, we turn that stuff off, and we'd be able to give to God and do some stuff like that. Y'all giving the Ashkenazi, Luciferian, devil-worshipping companies anyway. That's all. Listen, you ain't going to pay your tithe, but I bet you pay that phone bill. All right? Usually people don't tithe because it's tight. Now, here's the other side of this. Check this out, Ms. Shalanda. Check this out. We don't tithe because we're too poor. But we're going to remain poor until we... Oh, man. If you look at everybody that's doing well in this church, if you we should play a game. We should just get up and walk around, and everybody that we know blessed by their car or what they wear, we should just walk up to the people we know blessed and say, "Do you tithe?" And I guarantee you, you're going to know the answer to that question. I guarantee you. I'm looking at them now. Do you tithe? Yep. Yeah. And we should do the opposite. Go to the people that look the brokest. I'm going to do that. But that's just, come on. All right. Come on, Pastor. Why people don't tithe? Because money tight. We too poor. Why people don't tithe? Because they're looking at Pastor. They're looking at Pastor. They want tithe because of what I drive. Or because of what I wear. I wish everybody had that understanding. All right? I wish everybody had that understanding. But you see, the Negro is so messed up in his head. Now, look. Let me get racial for a second. I'm about to get real racial. I wish I could use the words I want to use. Because the Negro going to go to the white church. All right? Now listen to me. The Negro going to go to the white church. And the Negro going to tithe at the white church. And he ain't going to care what type of house the white pastor live in, what kind of car the white pastor drive, how many vacations he take, what kind of boat he drive. Whether his house paid for or not, the Negro is not going to cut that with the white pastor. All right? All right? All right? But let me tell you what the Negro will be concerned about. If he got a Negro pastor with the same kind of house, same kind of car, go on vacation, he won't pay his tithe to the white pastor, but he ain't paying his tithe to the Negro pastor. He not doing it. He not doing it. Because we've been bred to hate each other and to not want each other to move up. We've been bred, amen, if one of us get a little bit up, that we to pull the other one down. The Negro without the Lord is messed up. All right? But we got to refuse that Willie Lynch mentality in here. We got to refuse that. Because the same time you won't want me to get my check for work that I do. You understand me? Work, man. People. Mabel, you know how much go into teaching, man. People that know the work, it is so much work that the disciples in Acts 6 say, we not gonna go serve tables, we gonna stay in prayer and in the word. So somehow for my work, I can't get paid. Now here, come on, y'all sit down. I can't get paid, all right? But Oprah can get paid, all right? All right? 50 Cent can get paid. Tyler Perry can get paid. Now, let me tell you how the devil got the church mind messed up. All right? Now, the people who bring into us the word of life. Teaching us how to be saved, how to get to heaven, how to have a good family, a happy marriage, raise some good kids, have a good wholesome life, and then die, go to glory. Right? They're giving us life. The people that's giving us life, they can't get paid, Maisha. They can't get paid. Look at the angle of the devil. They can't get paid. They have to live in poverty. Now, that's not what God said. God said he that teach the gospel should live off the gospel. Not scrape off the gospel. Live off the gospel. God said in his word, you don't muzzle the ox that tread the corn. That's what God said. The one that labor in the word is not a word of just honor, but double honor. That's what God said in his word. Now, you got to know their system, how they flip it. They want the first thing they do when they get a preacher on TV, oh, what about your house? How much you get paid? I look at Oprah, what about your house? And how much you get paid? Go talk to them boys over there. That's not, okay. Hit it. This is what I do. Now watch what they do. And it's all right for them to get paid. Gang violence in our neighborhoods. Fornication and harlotry and prostitution amongst our children. Homosexuality in our schools. And that's the people that's peddling death. And sister-in-law, it's all right for them to get paid. Now, if I was a young man looking upon what could I do in life? I'm a young man, and I have, like, a good mind. You know, I'm hypothetically speaking, a young man with a good mind, oratorical skills, amen, different resources to be able to run corporations and administration and different boards and different things like that. I'm talking about like a CEO with some public appeal. Hallelujah. Know some things. Amen. So he's thinking about, I got all these gifts. I got all these tasks. What should I do in life? Should I do something for the Lord where the world says should live in poverty and should not have anything? Or should I go manage a record company and put out filth and debt and prostitution to my people? Without the right guidance, which one would that young man choose? The field. I'm trying to show you something. The devil done played the church. Why are people not tithing? They looking at me. Why are people not tithing? Because they selfish. They're selfish, man. got to get out of here. Oh, we got to get out. They're selfish. And that selfishness, amen, is based upon, I don't care about what the church can do. What is it? What's in it for me? All right, for those selfish, God knew you would be selfish. So he put in Malachi verse 11. Now, for me, I'm a tithe. I don't even need this rest of this stuff. I don't even need the blessings. I'm a tithe, number one, because he told me, and I want to see his house blessed. That's all I need. He ain't got to give me nothing. I'm a tithe. He don't have to give me nothing. All right? But for those that do tithe, look what he said. Look what he said he's going to do. He said, look. No, no, no. Verse 10. Go to verse 10. We're going to just read through. We got to get out of here. Bring you all the tithe in the storehouse. Hallelujah. Don't know, I ain't got my glasses on. Bring you all the tithe in the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. He says, prove me now herewith and see, the Lord of hosts, if I will not open to you the windows of heaven and pour you out, empty out on you, a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive. So God says, listen, for those that can give, for the church to do well, and for the gospel to get out, you know, for the word to be on TV, you can be saved. Give, because God says, I'm going to bless you for giving. I'm going to open up the windows of heaven. Amen? Now, if you like me, you're going to give anyway. This is just a lanyard. This is just added benefit. You know? And he's been faithful to his word. Verse 11, and I'll rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy fruit to your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts. And all nations shall call you blessed, for you shall be a delightsome land, said the Lord of hosts. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen to me. Listen to me. We're gonna do tithes and offerings. Amen. We're going to do tithes and offerings. And the way we're going to do it, hallelujah, the way we're going to do it, hallelujah, we're going to position our ushers. Hallelujah. We're going to position our ushers. Amen. Ooh, I wish I had time. Got a couple of minutes? Ushers, come up. Come up to the altar. Come up to the altar. Come up to the altar. All right? All right. This is what we're going to do. Amen. We're going to do altar call. And we're going to do offering too. All right. Only thing is that if I call the altar call, y'all got to make sure y'all give people space to come and give their offering. I think we can work it out, Abby. That was a no, sir, in the spirit. Listen. Come and bring your offering first. Then we're going to do the altar call. Thank you, my love. I read you. I know you. Come and bring your offering. 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 Come and bring your tithe. Come and bring your offering. Come and bring your tithe. Come and bring your offering. Come and bring your tithe. Come and bring your offering. And come and bring your tithe. Come on and bring your offering. And come on, bring your tithe. He deserves it. Come and bring your offering. And come on, bring your tithe. Our God deserves the praise. He let us live here, y'all. He give us life, y'all. He gave us salvation. Come on and bring your offering. Come on and bring your offering. Don't you ever be ashamed about bringing your offering to the Most High God. Come and bring your offering. Come on, bring your tithe. Come on, give your best. Come on, give it to the Lord. Remember what he said. Amen. They're going to be broke until they learn and give me the tithe. That's what he said. I'm telling you. I'm telling you. I'm telling you. I could discern his presence at this altar already. I could discern his presence at the altar already. You see, because tithing and work. and giving is worship. It's worship. That's what it is. That's what it is. If you're here today, amen. You say, Pastor, how in the world you get to the gospel from tithes and offerings? You know how I get to it? Because whatever you love, you're going to give. All right? Whatever you love, you're going to give. If you love God, you're going to give to his house. Now, let me tell you what God did for you. For God so loved the world, hey, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That's how much he loves us. You see, we sit here and we don't give him nothing. But he loved us so much, he gave his life for us. He gave us, hallelujah, his son Jesus. And I'm telling you, I don't know who I'm talking to in here. Listen, if you're not saved, then his salvation is easy. All you got to do is admit you're a sinner, believe in God, his word, how he came and lived a perfect life, died on the cross, and he was buried in the grave, and he rose on the third day. All you got to do is open your mouth and confess Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord this morning shall be saved. Listen to me. If you are here and you're unsure about your salvation, you can come to this altar. You can come to this altar. I'm going to pray with you, and you're going to be saved this morning. You're going to be saved this morning. If you're here and this word convicted you, and you've been shorting God in any way, and you've been slipping up on what you're supposed to be doing, come to the altar as well. If this word ministered you in any other way, the altar is open. Ushers, I'm going to release you. Go head on to the back. Hallelujah. Leaders, that's go with them. Go with them. Hallelujah. Go with them. Brother Duck, I'm going to need you with them. G Money, go ahead. Go with them. Amen. Minister Ann, hallelujah. It's altar call time. It's altar call time. You heard the call. Come. Come. Come to this altar. Come to this altar. Come to this altar. God so loved the world that he gave. That he gave. That he gave. Why should I give to God? Because he gave to me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's one of the givers right there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to pray a little bit. We're going to pray. Hallelujah. Just come if you're coming. Hallelujah. Just come. Hallelujah. We're going to pray a little bit. Hallelujah. There's some people here, man, I'm telling you, you at this altar and you ready for God to make you a giver and a tither. You want to be that. You want to be that. I guarantee you, God's going to bless you. I remember the day that I decided that I would no longer not tithe in the church. It was a day. I drew the line. I said, it's not going to happen. I'm tithing on everything. And let me tell you, I have been faithful to him. He has been faithful to me. Every single thing that I do. Everything. You see? It don't matter if I was in the law or I was preaching. No matter what I put my hands to, it was blessed because of the tithe. I could leave church right now and go do something. Go practice. I could go pick up cans. I know it's going to be blessed because I'm a tither. That's the confidence I have. That's the hope I have. Some of y'all ain't got no hope because you had not been faithful. The tithe is going to give you a hope. Pray with me now. Say, God, thank you for the truth. I admit I've sinned against you, and I'm sorry. Lord, please forgive me. I believe that you died on the cross for all my sins. I believe you were buried in the grave. I believe you rose on the third day. Lord, save me, a sinner, and use me, God, for your glory. I'm asking for you to bless me indeed. I will tithe. I will give. Bless me, Lord. You can use me. You can count on me. I will build your church. I will be faithful in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, give God some glory. Come on, give him some glory. That's all he's looking for. That's all he's looking for is a faithful man, a faithful man, a faithful woman to give his blessings to. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and bless you with peace, with shalom, peace and prosperity. Hallelujah. You, your children, and your children's children. In Jesus' mighty, wonderful name we pray. Amen. 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 Love y'all. Be blessed.